So our first speaker is a member actually of the College Advisory Board. It's Michael Alexin, and he's the VP for Product Design and Development at Target Corporation. Now, he's led design and development for Target, Target's apparel and accessories business since 2002. And prior to Target, he was at Eddie Bauer, worked for in apparel merchandising at Nike, also worked at Levi Strauss. And what's amazing about, I think you'll hear from all of our speakers, but it's particularly true for Michael as well, is how many of our speakers tonight sort of work in the community and community-related issues. So Michael served on the Bridge for Youth in Minneapolis Board of Directors for 8 years. He also was on the President's Advisory Council for his alma mater, which was Oberlin College. And Michael enjoys travel, boating, landscape painting, interior design, and I hear that he's crazy about his dog, Spike. So please welcome Michael Alexin.
Great. Good evening, everybody. I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing to go first, but how much can happen in 7 minutes? So we'll just dive in. So it's really great to be here tonight to share a couple of things I've learned along the way. But the truth is, I actually wasn't looking forward to this talk. If you would ask me to speak for an hour on innovation or product design and development, no problem. But 7 minutes to tell a more personal story, that's really scary. But then recently, I woke up at 3:45 in the morning one night because my little dog Spike had to pee. And the only thing worse than getting up in the middle of the night to take him out in below zero temperature is not taking him out and watching him smugly pee on my comforter. So I did take him outside. And when I crawled back in bed to resume my sleep, I sort of got into that in-between state where you're not really sure if you're dreaming or awake. And all of a sudden, the framework of a story just sort of appeared to me. And so here I am. So lying there drifting, I was taken back to a time when I was 5 years old in kindergarten, and I drew a picture for my mom of my favorite Christmas song, Silent Night. And I guess I was thinking about this because it was near Christmas time when I woke up. So my drawing was of the nativity scene with the three main characters from the song. So when I gave it to my mom, she said, "What a nice drawing, but who is the large man standing there in the manger?" Well, I was so surprised she had to ask, because everybody knows how the song goes. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round John, virgin, mother, and child. And so, being more of a visual than an audio type of guy, I sort of drew it like I heard it. And to this day, you know, I still make up my own words to songs when I'm not sure what the real ones are. And, you know, I guess that sort of imbues the songs with some new meaning. You could say that creativity was always sort of my fallback skill when I lacked actual knowledge, even if it sometimes got me in trouble. Anyway, I also used this technique when I began learning Spanish at about 8 years old. And when you're learning a new language, it can be a little dangerous to make up new words. For example, if you don't know the slang word for saying something is really cool in Spanish, so you make up the word culo, you're in trouble because culo means ass in Spanish, if you take in Spanish. So I quickly learned that, you know, all the creativity you have doesn't really substitute for plodding along, memorizing vocabulary, and actually, you know, practicing grammar. So I persisted, and I actually learned enough Spanish to sort of blow through all the high school Spanish texts by the time I was in about ninth grade. So yeah, I loved it, but I thought, what was I ever going to do with this Spanish? And it was about that time in my life that I first became aware that I really did have some sort of angel or maybe a fairy godmother helping me out in my life, and her name was Sarah Andipity. So as I look back, my whole life would have been completely different, maybe not quite as interesting, had Sarah not presented me with an unimaginable opportunity that I somehow found the courage and the resources to take advantage of. So the story goes, lo and behold, my mom's cousin was transferred down to Venezuela with his family, none of whom spoke any Spanish. And so my cousin wrote to my mom and me, inviting me to come down and live with them for a year, since they knew I'd been good at Spanish in school. And so my parents were really reluctant reluctant, but in the end, my mom said that serendipity had intervened. So it couldn't be just mere coincidence. There was a bigger reason why I was being presented with this opportunity in my young life. So finally, they let me go, and I spent my 11th grade year as the only American in a class of 40 Venezuelan kids. So that was, as you can imagine, a life-forming and life-changing experience for me. And every day brought me new situations that I could never have imagined. You know, some of them were wonderful, some were challenging, but it never would have happened without that sort of wild-ass coincidence that my new friend, Sarah Endipity, helped engineer for me. So about that point in my life, I had learned two really valuable things that would serve me well through my whole life and in my career. First, that persistence pays off. So if I hadn't worked so hard to learn Spanish over my young lifetime, I would have never been invited to live in South America. But still, you know, persistence is a long road of trial and error that isn't always fun, but it sort of always takes you where you want to go. The second thing I learned by that time is that serendipity is real. It's how the universe works, and it almost always takes you, somewhere new. Serendipity presents you with opportunities that I sort of imagine to be wormholes in the universe. If you're aware enough to realize them when they open up, and you're brave enough to jump in, they'll zoom you to somewhere you could hardly have ever imagined. And I've also learned that you can influence serendipity with your intent, so where you land won't be quite so random. So you're probably wondering by this point in my talk, what does this have to do with anything? Well, as I look back at the winding road that's been my life, I now know that persistence and serendipity have been two fundamental forces underlying everything. And in my career, I've learned that these forces are also fundamental to driving innovation. So I can tell you, innovation doesn't usually happen naturally in a corporate environment. The path to innovation has to be deliberate, just as the spark of innovation has to be nurtured. So to innovate, you have to make a conscious choice to take a journey that hasn't been traveled before, or you know, maybe it's fraught with risks or even failure that takes you into the unknown. And moving forward requires persistence fueled by vision, passion, and hope. So to innovate, you also have to be willing to embrace change and ambiguity and to explore the opportunities presented by our old friend serendipity. She speaks to you through your intuition. It's a gut feeling, that fleeting spark of possibilities is yet unrealized, and maybe even connections between seemingly unrelated things. And exploring these helps you land on something breakthrough. And the process of innovation is one of persistence. You have to test, fail, and iterate to see which of your ideas will actually work or solve a problem in a new way. And you have to fail fast. Bob Johansson of the Institute of the Future said, "Fail early, often, and cheaply." Then you get back up and do it again. So you could think of persistence as the driving force behind the iterative nature of innovation and serendipity as the inspiration. It is the way it really all works. And you won't be alone on this path. The makers of WD-40 tested 39 unsuccessful water displacement formulas before hitting on one that worked. And James Dyson tried 5,000 vacuum cleaner prototypes. And Edison, 10,000 versions of a light bulb. Again, the key is to fail fast, try quickly, and move on. And I can tell you from experience that persistence trumps genius almost every time. And Einstein himself once said, once we accept our limits, we go beyond them. And so I'll just tell you, in the end, life is truly a remarkable journey. Persistence has kept me on my path, and serendipity has revealed to me those wormholes that have taken me somewhere new. And I also like what George Burns once said, I'd rather be a failure at something I love than a success at something I hate. So I have given up on drawing songs, still love to paint, and see, you know, as I listen to those whispers of serendipity where it takes me. So thank you.